Bible studies, like a close reading of the Bible, where you study the Word. Who's familiar with conducted Bible study and prayers? Not just familiar, but you've actually done it. Really? All right, we're going to change this class. We're going to do a class. No, I'm just joking. You should know how to do inductive Bible study. That's actually a really important skill to have when you're reading the Bible. But another way that you can read the Bible is to read it devotionally, to read it meditatively. And in a way, that's when you read the Psalms, when you read the Old Testament, people talking about treasuring the Word of God in their hearts, meditating upon it day and night. This is what we're talking about. And this is important because I firmly believe that God desires to speak to us, to each one of us. He desires to be in a relationship with us, which is a love relationship. And with any kind of relationship, you can't have a relationship with somebody that you never hear from. Right? That would be really odd. Right? Here's my girlfriend. She never talks to me. Right? I'm married to Sunny. We haven't said a word in 7 years. That would be really odd. Right? I mean, it's such an obvious point. When you're in a relationship with somebody, you desire to hear their voice. You desire to hear from them. And the Word of God is the primary and foremost way that God speaks to us today. Okay? There are other ways. And actually, we're going to talk about that as we go through the seminar, but the most reliable way of hearing from God is right here. Okay, and as we treasure God's Word in our heart, as we have a relationship with Him through the Word, I guarantee you, okay, this is a money back guarantee. You paid zero for the seminar, I'll give you zero, but it's a money back guarantee. You are going to hear from God if you spend time with Him in His Word. Okay, let's read a couple of verses to get us into this. Why don't you turn first of all to the famous passage in 2 Timothy chapter 3. 2 Timothy 3.
By the washing of the Word. Okay?
There's a sense in which when we hear the word, we can be cleansed by it. Okay? We talked today, Pastor Victor was talking about, you know, the things that weigh us down, things that stop us from pursuing God and saying, yet, you know, living radical faith. Well, that's one of the ways that we wash ourselves clean of those things is through the word. Okay, it's through the word. I can't emphasize enough how important it is for you to, if you are serious about pursuing a love relationship with God, to be a person of the word. Amen? Amen. Those of you who go on missions, can't emphasize enough, like going for a year, can't emphasize enough how important it is for you to have a love relationship with God, you know, through the word. Right? Because there are going to be times when you're going to be lonely. There are going to be times, and this is true for all of us, there are times when, you know, it's going to be difficult. You need to have a relationship with the Word. Not really a relationship with the Word, a relationship with God. Okay? And right here in these pages, God speaks to us. Okay? Alright, so I mentioned before, lectio and devina. This is a way that we can read the Word. And it's based on, some principles that I'll just quickly share. I kind of talked about it already. The first thing, God desires to be in a love relationship with us. You need to know this, okay? And because of that, he desires to speak to us. He desires to actually speak to you. And we just learned God's word is living and breathing, okay? God's word can transform our lives. And these are some of the principles that we need to know as we go into understanding what lectio divina is. Okay. Now, the best way for me to like teach you what lectio divina is, contemplative Bible reading is actually just to do it. Okay. And I'm going to. So my plan is I'm going to show you how I read. This isn't how I read scripture all the time. But this is how I read scripture, and then. You're going to do it yourself, okay? So I'm going to do it for about like half an hour, and then I'm just going to, this is going to be awkward in truth for me, because when I normally do it, I don't talk out loud, right, and share out my thoughts out loud. But what I'm going to try to do is, as best as possible, I'm going to share what is going on in my heart and my mind as I read the Word of God. And here's the thing, God speaks to us through these words, and God speaks to us as we read these words and as we pray through the words. Okay? There are four main sort of elements of lectio divina, contemplative reading. This is just to get a little formal, just so you feel like there's some teaching involved here. The four like elements are first lectio, which is a Latin word, which means just reading. Okay, lectio, lectio, divina, lectio. The second is meditatio, or meditation. Okay, so the second element is first, you don't just read it, you're going to meditate on the word. Okay, we'll talk about what that means. But basically, meditating is, is to chew on the word, is to allow it just to kind of like, boil around in your heart. Okay, just kind of like, just stay there and just chew and chew and chew. And then there's a third element is oratio, which basically means you speak, right? And it's a dialogue, right? So you read it, you meditate on it, and then you speak to God in prayer, okay? You speak to God in prayer. And then finally, there's the fourth element. This isn't like a step-by-step thing. It's just going to all kind of happen together. But the fourth element is contemplatio. Probably butcher your pronunciation, but basically you're going to spend some time in contemplation, right? Contemplative Bible study, Bible reading, where you run, it's times just to be quiet, okay, before God, and just focusing on Him, okay? So this is, if you want to turn with me to Mark, I'm going through Mark just in my own Bible reading, so... I'm going to pick off where I last started, which is, or ended, which is chapter 4. So I'm going to read from verse 1 until until verse 8. Okay, verse 1 through 8. Now, for 8 verses, I can spend, very easily, I can spend half an hour on these verses. Okay, lectio devina is not speed reading. Obviously, it's not like reading for content, it's not reading for knowledge. It's reading so that you enter into a conversation with God. Okay, and you'll see this as I do this, but basically, my expectation is that as I read the Word of God, God is going to speak to me. Okay, how many of you feel like you've heard the voice of God before? Confidently. All right. How many feel like you've heard the voice or heard God speak to you through Scripture specifically? Okay. Hopefully by today, all of you will feel like God spoke to me today. Okay. All right. Let me pray first. Father, as I Lord, I enter into your word, I just ask you to come and speak. Benefit my brothers and sisters through me, that you would know that you are a holy and loving God, that you are able to direct our thoughts, Lord, that you are able to speak, God, in ways that maybe we weren't even aware of. Lord, I pray, God, that you would give us discernment today, that we would be able to distinguish between our own thoughts thoughts that are placed into our hearts, our minds, by you. And Lord, we ask in fact that you would guide all of our thoughts. Lord, I surrender my heart to you, Lord, and help me, God, to read and to enter into a conversation with you today, that I will know you more, that I will be able to walk in intimacy with you. Lord, that you would direct my every step. I pray this in Jesus' name. Again, Jesus began to teach by the lake. The crowd that gathered around him was so large that he got into a boat and sat in it out on the lake, while all the people were along the shore at the water's edge. He taught them many things by parables, and his teaching said, "Listen, a farmer went out to sow his seed. As he was scattering the seed, some fell along the path, and the birds came and ate it up. Some fell in rocky places where it did not have much soil, and sprang up quickly, because the soil was shallow. But when the sun came up, the plants were scorched, and they withered because they had no root. Other seed fell among thorns, which grew up and choked the plants, so that they did not bear green. Still other seed fell on good soil. It came up, grew, and produced a crop, multiplying 30, 60, or even 100 times." Again, Jesus began to teach by the lake. The crowd that gathered around him was so large that he got into a boat and sat in it out on the lake, while all the people were along the shore at the water's edge. He taught them many things by parables, and in his teaching said, "Listen, a farmer went out to sow his seed. As he was scattering the seed, some fell along the path, the birds came and ate it up. Some fell on rocky places where it did not have much soil. It sprang up quickly because the soil shallow. But when the sun came up, the plants were scorched and withered because they had no root. Other seed fell among thorns, which grew up and choked the plants, so that they did not bear grain. So other seed fell on good soil. It came up, grew, and produced a crop, multiplying 30, 60, or even 100 times." Again, Jesus began to teach by the way. Now, the reason I'm repeating this over and over reading is because, I'll be honest, the first time I read through it, even the second time, I didn't get much out of it. This is a parable that I've heard many times. I've preached on it a couple of times. I've studied it. And so part of me feels like I know this. And in order for me to break through that that sort of feeling that I have, that I know this, I don't really need to read this again. I can just skip it. In fact, I could preach a message on it right now for you. Like, that feeling, in order for me to break through it, God to break through the wall of complacency, the wall of knowledge that I think I have, what I need to do is have patience and go back and read it again. lectio devina, you're going to read contemplative Bible reading. You don't just read it once or twice. You're going to read it over and over and over and over again. And as you, your heart begins to open up to the Word, God will begin to speak to you. Okay, through the Word. Again, Jesus began to teach by the lake. The crowd that gathered around him was so large that he got into a boat and sat in it out on the lake while all the people were along the shore at the water's edge. And he taught them many things by parables. And his teaching said, "Listen, a farmer went out to sow his seed. As he was scattering the seed, some fell along the path, and the birds came and ate it up. Some fell in rocky places where it did not have much soil. It sprang up quickly because the soil was shallow. But when the sun came up, the plants were scorched and they withered because they had no root. Another seed fell among thorns, which grew up and choked the plants so they did not bear grain. Still other seeds fell on good soil. They came up, grew, and produced the crop, multiplying 30, 60, or even 100 times. Now that time when I read it, my heart began, like I could feel God sort of to tug at my heart at certain parts of this passage. Okay? But it's not like a strong enough feeling where I'm just going to go, okay, I'm going to focus on that. But I'm going to listen. Say, God, what are you saying to me through this? Again, Jesus began to teach by the lake. The crowd that gathered around him was so large that he got into a boat and sat in it out on the lake while all the people were along the shore at the water's edge. And he taught them many things by parables. And in his teaching said, "Listen, listen." Now that word just sticks out to me. I'm going to come back to that. Listen, a farmer went out to sow his seed. As he was scattering the seed, some fell along the path, and the birds came and ate it up. Some fell on rocky places, where it did not have much soil. It sprang up quickly, because the soil was shallow. I don't know why, but for some reason, that sentence just kind of, sticks in my heart somehow. It sprang up quickly because the soil was shallow. But when the sun came up, the plants were scorched, and they withered because they had no root. Other seed fell among thorns, which grew up and choked the plants, so that they did not bear a grain. Still other seed fell on good soil, came up, grew, and produced the crop, multiplying 30, 60, or even 100 times. What I want to do is actually probably read it through a couple more times, but as you do it, God will just begin to focus your heart, your eyes even on specific verses. And so I'm going to focus and concentrate from verse 3 on. Okay? And so what I'm going to do is I want to get deeper in verse 3 through verse 8. Listen. Listen. You know, right now, I feel like God is saying, to me, saying, "Listen, I want your attention right now. Listen." A farmer went out to sow his seed. As he was scattering the seed, some fell along the path. Some fell along the path, and birds came and ate it up. Some fell on rocky places where it did not have much soil. It sprang up quickly because the soil was shallow. And when the sun came up, the plants were scorched and withered because they had no root. Other seed fell among thorns, which grew up and choked the plants, so that they did not bear grain. Other seed fell among thorns, which grew up and choked the plants, so that they did not bear grain. or seed fell among thorns, which grew up and choked the plants, so that it did not bear grain. Still other seed fell on good soil. It came up, grew, produced the crop, multiplying 30, 60, or even 100 times. Again, Jesus began to teach by the way. I just feel like the Holy Spirit is telling me to do this again. I might have missed something here. The crowd that gathered around him was so large that he got into a boat and sat in it out on the lake. The crowd that gathered around him was so large that he got into a boat and sat in it out on the lake. And as I read that again, you know, I realize that one of the things that's going on in my heart right now is, you know, I want to have a large crowd gathered around me. You know, the ministry of Jesus, this aspect like attracts me. When I think about symphony, I realize I want to have a crowd that is so large that I have to get out, you know, away from the crowd and sit in a boat in the middle of a lake so that everyone can see me. You know, there's a part of me that is, you know, I sense that, I know that actually that there's a part of me that wants, you know, this kind of success, if you will. And that's what I, you know, God is telling me right now. That one of the reasons that I'm attracted to this verse is because that's what I want. You know, there's a crowd that gathered around him so large that God took a boat and sat in it out on the lake. Well, all the people were along the shore at the water's edge. And he taught them many things by parables, and his teaching said, "Listen, Mary, listen." The farmer went out to sow his seed. And right now, I feel like I've heard this thought of God saying, you know, Mary, I'm sowing my seed right now. I'm sowing my seed right now. I am the one sowing. I am the sower. Okay. Now, how do I distinguish between what is like the thought of God and what is a thought just for myself? Well, right now, I'm going to just trust that God is directing my thoughts as I immerse myself in Scripture. Okay, now there are some things that I know that aren't my thoughts. I know that they're my thoughts. But one of the things that God can do, and people have known this for centuries, is that God can, you know, put thoughts inside of you. Right? And one of the things that you need to be able to learn to do is to be able to trust when God speaks and it sounds like your voice. Okay? Now there are times when God is going to speak and it's not going to sound like your voice, and you're going to know very clearly it's God. Okay? But right now, actually for me, like, I know God is going to speak because he uses my first name. Okay? He says Barry. Right? And I'm not like prone to talking to myself. I don't give myself pep talks. Come on, Barry, you can do it. You know, that's not just not how I talk to people or think. So when a thought comes and says Barry, I go, okay. And maybe that's the way it'll work for you. But listen, a farmer went out to sow his seed. And as he was scattering the seed, some fell along the path, and the birds came and gathered up. As he was scattering the seed, some fell along the path, and the birds came and gathered up. As he was scattering the seed, some fell along the path, and the birds came and ate it up. As he was scattering the seed, some fell along the path, and the birds came and ate it up. The seeds never had a chance to germinate. They never grew. They never, nothing came of it. The birds immediately came and ate it up. And, right now, God, I'm just saying, this happens to you, Barry. Sometimes seed, falls in your heart, and nothing happens. Nothing happens. Some fell on rocky places where it did not have much soil, and it sprang up quickly because the soil was shallow. Some fell in rocky places where it did not have much soil. It sprang quickly because the soil was shallow. But when the sun came up, the plants were scorched and withered because they had no root. Sun fell on rocky places where it did not have much soil, but it sprang up quickly because the soil was shallow. And when the sun came up, the plants were scorched and withered because they had no root. Sun fell on rocky places where it did not have much soil, it sprang up quickly because the soil was shallow. But when the sun came up, the plants were scorched and withered because they had no root. I talked about how I want simply to grow into a giant crab, but I think God is giving me a warning, saying, just because it springs up quickly doesn't mean that the plant is healthy, the soil is healthy. God is saying, some of the growth that you've been, you're so excited about, it's shallow growth soil, it's shallow soil growth. Right? This would be a great time, actually. I haven't been doing this, but it would be a great time to respond to God in prayer. Right? So I would say, just pray, God, as you are revealing that there is growth that is possible because the soil is shallow and there isn't much resistance immediately. Lord, may I not also get excited when I'm placed because of the people who come to church. Lord, I pray, God, that you would clear the rocky places. God, help me to know that there is so much more work that needs to be done. So many rocky places, so many rocks that need to be removed. And hearts before they can truly, truly produce a crop. Lord, may I not get excited just because people have come, but may I get excited when a crop is produced. When they produce a crop, when they show fruit of the Holy Spirit in their lives, when a life change happens. God, may you help me, God. Lord, I'm so satisfied with superficial results. I'm so satisfied appearance of success. I'm so satisfied by so little. Lord, help me. Thank you for just revealing the shallowness of my own heart and my own ambitions. Lord God, may I desire something more. May I desire nothing less than the Holy Spirit. Spirit-inspired crop, where your word comes and produces life change, culture change. Other seed fell among thorns which grew up and choked the plant so they did not bear fruit. And still other seed fell on good soil, and it came up, grew, and produced the crop, multiplying 30, 60, 100 times. So other seed fell on good soil, came and grew, produced a crop, multiplied 30, 60, or even 100 times. A question springs to my mind. God, why do you sow? Why are you sowing on rocky places? Why are you sowing sowing on thorns? God, why aren't you making our hearts all good soil? For a minute, as I asked that question, the word just popped into my mind. It's patience, God saying, patience. And I hear him say, I am the dark. And I will sow my seed generously, and I will sow my seed in hopes that people will respond. But be patient, for I am the garden, and I will take out the rocks, and I will take out the thorns. I will break up the rocky path. Father, Lord, I don't understand why you can't do this prayer. Lord, I don't know why. Lord, I wish you would just do this quicker. I just wish you would break the path, the rocky paths of the paths and the rocky areas of my own heart. Lord, you would do it quickly. Again, Jesus began to teach by the lake. The crowd that gathered around him was so large that he got into a boat and sat in it out on the lake. While all the people along the shore at the water's edge, he taught them many things by parables. And his teaching said, listen. Listen. The farmer went out to sow his seed. And as he was scattering the seed, some fell along the path. Birds came. Some fell in rocky places where it did not have much soil. It sprang up quickly as the soil was shallow, and when the sun came up, the plants were scorched and withered because they had no fruit. Other seed fell on thorns which grew up and choked the plants, and they did not bear grain. So other seed fell on the soil, came up and grew, and produced a crop, multiplied 30, 60, or 100 times. That time, Isaiah, I read through it again. Word that drew my attention. Initially, listen. That's it hit me again. And, what I think God really wants is for me to listen. Stop presuming. Stop thinking I know what I'm doing. And to stop, to a certain extent, taking the word for granted. Just to listen. To stop and to listen. Father, I ask that you help me to do this. Lord, help me to listen. Or help me to be so less impatient. Help me to sit and wait upon your word, to wait upon your direction, to listen when you speak, to really focus my ears on what you are saying. Focus my ears in the journey of my revelation, that I would not be thinking about what needs to be done, that I would not think about message that I can preach this Sunday, that I would listen as the Word of God is preached. That you would help me to take care of all distractions. That I would listen. That I would really listen. That I would fight through fatigue and fight through just wanting to fall asleep. Help me listen. To know that there's a word that's going to be planted that's going to bear fruit. word for all of you, actually. God is saying, I want you to listen. Pay attention, because there's something in me, there's going to be something said that is going to, you know, that is actually just for you. Okay? Can't claim to know what the effect of it is going to be, but I feel like God is saying, listen, there's something going to be said that is just for you. It's just for you. Not for everyone necessarily, not for the person to the left of you, to the right of you, not for your friend. There's something that God wants to say to you during my revelation. So listen. Listen. Father, help us to do that. Help us, Lord, to really strain our ears more than open our ears. Lord, that we would hear. We would hear. And a great fruit, Lord God, would happen and would be produced in our lives. Thank you, God. Pray this in Jesus' name. Okay, so that was about 20 minutes. Just to kind of like reiterate it, and maybe I'll take a few questions before I send you off to do this on your own. Now, because I was like speaking out loud, there was very little time for me to just be silent, right? Because normally I'd be silent and kind of have these thoughts, and then I would speak. I don't think I did the best job, but I was trying as much as possible to kind of like let you know like kind of what was happening inside my mind and my heart. Okay? And I'm going to tell you a lot of things as you read this, as you just allow the Holy Spirit to just work through, to speak to you through the passage. It's going to happen in a number of different ways. It's going to happen to you maybe like physically, but it might be like you might have a physical reaction. Probably not, but you could. There could be like an emotional reaction. You don't even know why you have like a reaction, okay, to the word. Right? There's something that said it, and your heart's gonna respond, and you're not gonna know why. But when it does, pay attention to that. Okay? Be really in tune with what you feel like, you know, what God can be saying. Pay attention to, you know, your physical body, pay attention to your heart, pay attention to your mind. Thoughts will come. You know, sometimes thoughts will come, and it will be like, and you'll think, oh, you know, that's a distracting thought. You know, I'm going to push it away. When you're doing this, don't be so quick to push away thoughts that you feel like are distracting or irrelevant. Okay? In fact, it could be very well could be that God is actually speaking to you through those thoughts. Right? In fact, maybe that is something that, you know, that you really need to deal with. Okay? So you're like reading this, and then, you know, your mind pops over to, like, you know, I don't know why, like, you know, maybe one of your parents, right? Or sibling, or something like that. And you know, you can actually take the time. Don't like, oh, I need to focus. You know, that could be actually be God saying, hey, you know, this is something that's on your heart that you need to pray to me about, and take care of. Do you understand what I'm saying? You know, it's not like, this isn't like intercessory prayer, right? It's not like you're there going, I gotta pray for my church for the next half hour, right? I gotta stay on topic. It's allowing the Holy Spirit to just interrupt your thoughts, interrupt your life, okay? Now, when you do this, at the end of it, my encouragement is for you to write it down. Okay? To write it down in a journal. To write down, first of all, you know, like if you can summarize like one thought that you felt like God was giving to you. And for me, like if you know, there were some things, I feel like I really need to work on just trusting God. Continue to work on trusting God for the right kind of growth that's in me. trusting, you know, God, that He is at work, you know, and that I don't have to be so patient. You know, I need to write down these thoughts, because here's a reality for me, and I'm guessing this is a reality for most of you. You're going to forget. Right? You're going to forget. You're going to read this, and some of you might even go, wow, that was such a profound, like, you know, God really spoke to me clearly, and that was incredible. And then you're going to forget. I was talking with a brother, and unfortunately the guys in Symphony won't know who I'm talking about, but it's okay. I was talking with one brother, and he was telling me, oh man, Pastor Mary, I was at morning prayer, and I felt like God spoke so profoundly, and so, like, it was amazing. And I was like, well, what did he say? He's like, I can't remember. And, you know, it's funny, but you know what? That happens to all of us. Right? That happens to all of us. You know, it probably happened the last retreat that you were at. Maybe even last Sunday. Like, maybe even this morning. Like, you thought, oh, that was so great. What was it again that God said? So write it down. Okay, so take a journal and write it down. And read your journal over and over again so that you can remember what God said. Okay? Now, you can do this through the entire, all the books of Scripture. Okay? Granted, it'll be a little bit harder in the genealogies, but you can do this. Okay? It'll be a little harder in Numbers, you know, as they're going through, like, list after list. But, you know, there's actually, you know, like, I remember praying through, you know, the sacrifices. You know, like, I think it was in Deuteronomy, where they're going through, actually, no, it was in Numbers, where they're going through all the different, like, this is what they did. Like, they came and they brought, like, you know, and I can't remember, right? I read it so many times, I almost memorized it. It was like, they came and brought, like, five oxen, they brought, like, so many lambs, they brought so many, and it just, this repetition, right? Over and over again. And I was, the thing that struck me as I was reading that and just praying through it was just how, you know, how seriously they took sacrifice that they were to give to God. Okay? They didn't want to shortchange God. They gave God exactly what you know, he required. They were thorough, they knew exactly what they needed to know. And that was their part. They wanted to render unto God an appropriate sacrifice. And that was, you know, you can read through some, like, weird passages and God will speak to you. Okay? Because Scripture is living and breathing, and God is living and breathing. Okay? And he will speak to us. Amen? Okay, so this is what you're going to do. You are going to go to Psalm 121. And I'd like for you to read Psalm 121, and I'm going to give you 20 minutes to do this. Okay? Psalm 121 isn't that long a passage. So read Psalm 121, and then afterwards, I'm going to ask you for just like 10 minutes to just kind of pair up and share, like, what you felt like God was seeing to you through Psalm 121. Okay? Not just like this verse kind of hit me, like, just very personally, like, share, like, what you felt like God was saying to the extent that you feel comfortable. So try to find someone you feel comfortable sharing with. Okay? You know what to do, right? You're going to read through it multiple times until you feel like your heart is being, you know, is in a place where you can begin to hear God. And then begin to read it, you know, like, verse by verse, maybe repeating phrases, repeating the verse over and over again. Just allow God to speak. And as God speaks, don't read on. Stop and respond. Right? And pray. And then allow God to speak back. Keep reading, and continue to, even if it gets to the end. one where you're just like in one verse, one phrase, and that's all that you know. If that's what it comes out, that's awesome. Okay, like, it'd be better actually if it was as like clear and concise as possible. You know that God spoke to you through that one thing. Okay? So that's what you're doing. Anyone unclear?